You've always been with us. Every battle you've already won. Oh, we've already won. And there is no weapon that has ever left a mark on you. And there is no army with the power to conquer truth. You've always been with us. Every battle you've already won. We've already won. Show me one thing he can't do. Show me a mountain he can't move. He's the God of the breakthrough. Anything is possible. Show me one thing that's too hard. Show me waters he can't move. He's the God of the breakthrough. Anything is possible. It's possible. And there is a kingdom that's advancing at the speed of light. And in his kingdom, every dead thing is bound to rise. Oh God, our Redeemer, he is faithful to revive. Oh, he will revive. I sing out your name, a victory dance. I will dance out in faith. I will crush disappointment and break every chain. Now all of my fear I will turn into praise. Shake off despair as I sing out your name, a victory dance. I will dance out in faith. I will crush disappointment.
Woo! You good? I was going. I was right in the spirit. There we go. That's right.
Sing of your goodness, I will sing of your love. Though the seasons come quickly, you have always been enough. Though the night may get dark, though the waiting seems long, you have always been faithful to remind me of your love. And you
Keep on getting better. God's good, isn't he? God's good? Man, he's good in the morning. He's good in the evening. He is always good, always good. Hey, y'all can have a seat, man. I'm so thankful you guys have joined us today. For those of you that are here in Conway, for anybody who's watching online or maybe you're watching on demand later, whatever has brought you here today, we're thankful for you. And let me just say this, if you're online or on demand, we would love to connect with you. You can go to the Connect Corner, that digital Connect Corner right there, and we'd love to connect with you further. There's many of you that are maybe here in Conway, and this might be your first time ever being with us here, and I would love to connect with you further. We'd love to connect with you. So please stop by the Connect Corner, just right there. You can see it. It's right inside the room. You don't even have to hit the lobby on your way out. Just head there, as we would love to just talk with you, and we've got a free gift for you that we'd love to give you, all right? Now, we're gonna go into this series that we've been calling Love Handles. This is week three, and the way we've talked about Love Handles is we've said that it's when you've got to look at how does love handle certain relationships, and inside of these relationships, you've got to look and see how you use both truth and grace to handle it. That many times we look at relationships and we'll only give truth or we'll only give grace. And today we're going to talk more about how to give truth and grace inside of a relationship. And let me kind of say this just as a reminder that from the beginning we've said this is a conversation. That I know that I'm on stage and I'm going to kind of hog the conversation for 25, 30 minutes, but I want it to be a conversation. And that's one reason why we've put the question QR code on the screen, where you can hit that QR code and ask any kind of question you want to ask. Or we've made it pretty simple. You can just go to the Rock app and you can hit the Love Handles button, and by hitting that, you can ask a question. It'll be anonymous, all right? Now, we've had people doing that during every service. We've answered questions at the end of every service, so definitely want to encourage you to do that again. But there is one caveat. For those of you who are using an Android phone, let me first say this. It's not too late to come to Jesus. Okay, if you got an Android, it's not too late. You can still repent, and you can still come to know the Lord. But in all seriousness, the Google platform has had an issue with our app, and they are trying to fix that right now. So if you're an Apple user, it's not a problem. If you've had your app on your Android for a while, not a problem. But if you have a new phone or if you refresh, it might kill it. And again, that's kind of out of our hands. We keep talking to them. We're trying to get it fixed, but it's kind of on their court. So when they get it done, we'll be able to reinstall that on those of you who have Android phones. So we want you to ask a question. And we want to ask these questions about how love handles things. And like I said, in week one, we talked about how does love handle singleness and marriage, as we were talking about relationships. And we said, is it better to be single or is it better to be married? And we answered that by saying, well, do whatever is best to help you serve the Lord. And then last week we talked about how does love handle sex? And we talked about moral sex and immoral sex. And we talked about that a lot. And you guys must have listened really well, because this morning a bunch of you were talking to me about sex in the lobby. I don't want to hear about it once it leaves, okay? You know what I mean? Like, that's for you all to have your conversations, okay? But anyway, so we talked about that. Next week, we're going to talk about how does love handle the gift of life? And we're going to really look at the gift of life, and what we mean by that specifically is a child that you have in the womb, out of the womb. We're going to talk about that kind of gift of life, and we're going to hit it from this idea of grief. About if you've had a miscarriage, or if you've been infertile, or maybe it's post-abortion. And I've been interviewing and spending time with some of the ladies of our church and asking their testimonies. And we've actually caught those on video. And I want you to know that next week's going to be special. You're going to hear more from them than you hear from me, and it's going to be just an incredible weekend here at church. And I want to invite you to make sure you're back for it. But don't just keep it for you to come back. Chances are you know somebody who's dealing with the grief of that kind of loss. Chances are you know somebody who's maybe asking questions about the gift of life And I want to invite you to make sure that you bring them with you or encourage them to watch online. All right? So that's next week. Now this week, we're gonna tackle this question. How does love handle commitment? And when I think about commitment, I can be honest, and I think I can say this, that I think as people, we are really good at commitment. Like I might say it this way, that I think that as individuals, we are phenomenal at commitment until we don't want to be, right? Like anybody here ever decided to go on a diet before? Yeah, you're like, I don't want to raise my hand. But you know what I'm saying? Like, you're like, I'm committed. I'm in. I'm all in. It's Monday morning. It's going to be a great week. And then somebody brings cinnamon rolls, right? Like, no joke, today I'm talking about being committed to eating healthy, and somebody put a bakery item on my table back there. Or somebody last week brought me some cake pops, okay? You know what I mean? Like we're committed until we're not. Like we're committed to our exercise until we're not. We're committed to our New Year's resolution until we're not. And the same thing happens in relationships. Like, you have a friend, and you're committed to your friend. You're like, yeah, it's a great friendship, until they do something that you don't like, and then you're not. You're in a relationship, and you're committed until something happens, and then you're not. You're in a family unit, and all things are good until your brother does something or your mom does something, and then you're not. Like, we're committed until we don't want to be. And that same thing happens in marriage, that we're all in until we decide we don't want to be. And that's what I mean, like, we're great at commitment when we want it, but the minute we start thinking opposite, it's real quick to walk away from that. Like, you talk about your dating relationships. You've said it. He's the best dude in the world. And the next day later, that guy stinks. Right? Like, we're committed until we're not. Well, today I want us to talk about this idea of commitment in relationships. And what does it look like to be committed to that relationship? Right? And I'm talking a lot about friendships, a lot about family, a lot about marriage, all right? Now, it'll play into a dating relationship, but let's be honest, dating relationships, not all of them last, and for good reason. So it's okay to sometimes say, well, I don't want to stay in this dating relationship, so you release it. But there's other kinds of relationships that should last. A marriage should last. Family should last. Friendships, many friendships should last. So how do we remain in them rather than run from them? And I think that's what the Apostle Paul was trying to get at when he was talking to the Corinthian church. Because the Corinthian church had asked Paul about marriage and about relationships. And what he said, it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. He says in verse 17, 20, and 24. He says, remain, remain, remain. Three different times, three different verses, all in 1 Corinthians 7, he says, remain, remain, remain. Verse 17 reads like this: yes, each of you should remain as you were when God called you. Now, he was specifically saying that in reference to divorce. That's where he was specifically saying it. That some people in the church, they were asking him about divorce, and is it okay to divorce, or should I not divorce, or what should I do? So he gives them this idea of just remain in it, all right? And then he gives them some further knowledge, and I'll read from it in a second. But before I read from it, I just got to talk about divorce, because if we're willing to admit it, my guess is 70, maybe 75% of us in this room have dealt with divorce. And you might deal with divorce because you've been through a divorce. Or you might have to have dealt with divorce because your parents got a divorce. For some of you, your parents divorced like mine did when I was a newborn baby. As soon as I was born, my dad split. And some of you have that kind of story. Some of you have a story that you're my age and your mom and dad just split. They just divorced. And you're dealing with it now from a different angle. Some of you are teenagers and you're trying to figure it out because your mom and dad have divorced recently. And you're trying to walk that out and figure out, how do I navigate honoring my parents and all that. All right? So let's just off the beginning of the bat, let's just admit This is a difficult topic. Out of the 4 weeks, I'll be honest, this one's the hardest one for me to preach. As difficult as next week will be, this is the one that's the hardest because it's so messy. It's just a messy topic. It's a messy situation. And I think anybody who's been through a divorce, whether that's personally or whether you've seen a divorce happen in your parents, you would admit that it's painful, that divorce divides, that divorce destroys. I've never talked to anybody who's went through a divorce personally who didn't say that it wasn't a painful event and that it hasn't created mess in the family and in their lives, all right? That's just honest where it is. So we're dealing with something that I know when we talk about divorce, like really hits the heart. And then we ask questions like, well, can I remarry? Like, is it okay for me to divorce? Can I do this? Do I have to stay in this marriage? What do I do? And those are valid questions. And we're going to try to talk about a little bit of that as we talk about honoring commitments. And let's just start by going straight to God's word, because the people of the Corinthian church, they looked at Paul and they said, can we divorce? And Paul, he does the best thing. He says, well, what did Jesus say? And honestly, pretty much anything you're asking in life, that's probably the first question to then ask. Is whether it's about marriage, divorce, relationships, money, your job, your career, whatever. Well, what did Jesus say about something like this? Because a lot of times, he speaks to it. And when it comes to divorce, he spoke to it. This is what he said. It's 1 Corinthians 7, so this is Paul quoting Jesus. Paul said this, but those who are married, I have a command that comes not from me, but from the Lord. So he's basically saying, this is what Jesus said. A wife must not leave her husband, but if she does leave him, let her remain single or else be reconciled to him. And a husband must not leave his wife. That he's referring to a time that Jesus was being questioned by a bunch of religious leaders. And as Jesus was being questioned by these religious leaders, they said, hey, Moses said it's okay for us to get a divorce. Is it okay if we just do it for any reason? Get a divorce for any reason. And Jesus said, no, that's not okay, because that was never my intention. See, we got to remember the intention of marriage is that God created man and woman and brought them together in marriage. And when they got married, when they had sex, when they were together, they were one flesh. And as one flesh, they were one flesh emotionally, one flesh physically, one flesh spiritually. And what I mean by spiritually is marriage is meant to be a picture of our relationship with Jesus. We talked about this a lot last week, so I won't go very far with it. But it's supposed to be a picture of our relationship with Jesus. So Jesus is saying, I don't ever want to see divorce because it separates and it gives a picture that he's saying, I want you all to be together forever because that's what a relationship with me looks like. Now, he does then say, so if you do divorce and you remarry, it is committing adultery. And all that means, because I know that can be a tough verse, and you're like, what did Jesus mean by that? Again, his plan was, when you marry, one flesh. So when you go and remarry, you become one flesh there. That's what he means by that. And it wasn't his original intention. That's what Paul is getting at, all right? Because divorce divides, divorce destroys. But then Paul goes a step further, and he says, that's what the Lord has said already about marriage, but let me go a step further and talk about divorce. And that's this next verse. It says it this way. It says, now I'll speak to the rest of you, though. I do not have a direct command from the Lord. All he's saying there is, I quoted Jesus, and now I'm going to speak some biblical truth. So then Paul continues. He says, if a fellow believer has a wife who is not a believer and she is willing to continue living with him, he must not leave her. That all he's saying at that point is, you've asked a question, well, can I divorce my wife or can I divorce my husband even though they're not a believer? Like basically they're saying, I've chosen to follow Jesus and they're not, so can I just divorce them? And Paul says, no. He says, that's not part of God's intent. Stay together. And he says two verses later, for who knows, you might bring salvation to your spouse. That through your godly witness, through your lifestyle, through your prayers, You might help them come to know who the Lord is. And then he follows it by saying, and you will help your kids to be holy. It's going to help your kids. Basically saying that we know divorce is going to hurt the kids, so I want you to stay in them because you're going to help set them apart to be holy. That's the advice Paul is giving us. Now, he goes one step further and he says this, but if the husband or wife who isn't a believer insists on leaving, let them go. In such cases, the believing husband or wife is no longer bound to the other, for God has called you to live in peace. Now, this is just pretty simple. That basically what Paul is saying here is you can't make someone stay. Isn't that true? Like some of you have been in divorce situations that you didn't want it, you didn't ask for it, and next thing you know, your spouse took off. Right? Like it wasn't part of your desire, wasn't part of your intention, but they're gone, right? You can't force somebody to stay with you. And he was speaking specifically to if they're a believer or not a believer, but let's just be honest, it doesn't matter if they're a believer or not. You can't force somebody to stay with you. So what happens is what he says is when that happens, you're not bound. Live in peace. All right, so those are some caveats. Those are some things that he says. Here is the reasons divorce might happen. Yet, we must remember, it's not part of God's design. That's not part of God's intent. That God created relationships to last and created marriages to last. So let me kind of flip the script now and say this. So how do we remain in relationships, whether that's a friendship, whether that's family, whether that's a marriage? How do we remain in them rather than run from them? And what I would say is simply look at Jesus. See, I think oftentimes the minute we face conflict, the minute we face trouble, the minute we things become a struggle, we run from the relationship rather than remain in it. But think about Jesus. That wasn't the way he acted. Do you ever see Jesus running from a relationship just because it's difficult? If you think about it, it's actually the opposite. The minute the relationship got tough, Jesus ran to it to try to connect. Let's think about this for a second. That you can go back to the beginning of the Bible where Adam and Eve first sinned. And as soon as they sinned, they were ashamed, they felt naked, and then God came to meet with them. God came to say, hey, I want to connect. I want to be in relationship. And they're like, whoa, we've sinned. We messed up. And what they do? They ran and hid. But God didn't say, oh, you've messed up. I'm done with you. No, God continued to pursue them. That's what God does. And so much so that when Jesus came to this earth, he came to pursue us. Because each of us have broken relationship. Each of us have made our relationship with God difficult. You probably don't want to hear that. Let me speak personally for myself. I know I have personally made my relationship with Jesus difficult because I sin and I mess up. And although Jesus is 100% committed to me, there are times that I don't function in a way that I'm 100% committed to him. Anybody else with me or am I alone? Okay, all right, so now you get it, all right? But in that, Jesus doesn't leave us. Jesus comes to connect with us. He comes to say, I want to be in relationship with you. And we need to look at our relationships in that same way. That we need to start looking at our friendships, our family, our marriages, and say, when there's difficulty, don't run from the relationship, move to connect in the relationship. Like oftentimes as friends, what'll happen is you're everything's fine, and then everything's not fine, so then all of a sudden you start ghosting one another. Right? Like you quit texting, you quit talking, you're just like, there's a rift in our relationship, I'm done. Or that happens in dating relationships. Yet what Jesus shows us is when the relationship gets tough, run to it, don't run away from it. Connect with one another. In your marriage, oftentimes things might get difficult. You're like, I don't want to spend any time with them. The best thing you can do is get together, is start connecting together, is making sure that you're staying in unity there. Married couples, I'd say this. We need to spend more time going on walks. We need to spend more time going on drives. We need to spend more time at the dinner table talking. Well, as families, we need to spend more time talking. As friends, you need to spend more time talking. Rather than just jumping on social media or talking on your phone, then we need to actually get face-to-face because we need to connect in relationship rather than run from the relationship. But it goes a step further. See, Jesus didn't just connect with us. Jesus also spent time communicating. And again, when it comes to communication, if we're honest, we're pretty bad at it. Especially when there's a relationship rift, right? Well, like, in general, we're bad at it. Dudes, let me help you right now. You're bad at it. And I'm bad at it. Let me just prove it to you. As a guy, we think the definition of fine is good. But anytime your wife or your girlfriend looks at you and says, I'm fine, she ain't fine. Andy, she not fine if she says she's fine. Now, you can look at her and say, Mary, you fine. She likes that kind of fine. But any other fine is not a good fine, okay? So, dudes, just let me help you. That's not good communication, all right? But where we really struggle with communication is with truth and grace. And the reason why is most of us don't want to give out truth because we don't want to have conflict. Like your friend does something, and you're like, man, I need to tell my friend that just, that was mean. But I'm not going to say anything. And then they do it again, and you're like, well, that hurt my feelings. But rather than speak truth, well, I'm just going to give grace. And then what ends up happening is you just take truth and you put it like all the way down at the bottom. You'll be like, it'll be okay. But then they do it again, and they do it again. And they do it again, and they do it again. And before long, there's a lot of tension in that relationship. All right? Now, there's supposed to be good tension between truth and grace. This is where growth happens. But if the tension is because I've thrown truth to the bottom and I'm not willing to recognize it, well, then it's bad tension. This happens in marriages, that your spouse is doing something and you don't like it, so rather than say something about it, you'll just be like, it'll be okay, it'll be okay, I'm not going to say anything, I'm not going to say anything, I'm not going to say anything, I'm not. And then all of a sudden, we need a medic over here. But you see what I'm getting at? Like there's so much tension that eventually they say, and you're like, ah, and you just explode on them, all right? And when you do that, you break the whole thing. Which makes for a better illustration when that's how you communicate, it's going to lead to brokenness. It's going to lead to brokenness. When we're unwilling to share truth and grace, then we get so tense that we snap on somebody. That we blow up verbally when we shouldn't blow up verbally. We blow up and go do something because we're so mad at this person over here. We break relationship forever. And guys, we got to figure out a way to handle truth and grace like Jesus did. See, in every conflict, Jesus spoke truth and grace. There was never a conflict that we see in Scripture where Jesus didn't share both truth and grace. That he didn't just share truth, or he didn't just share grace. He shared grace and truth in the midst of conflict. Nicodemus came to him, and there was conflict. And Nicodemus was like, I don't understand this. And Jesus said, you know what? Truth. You need to be born again. Grace. You're not far from the kingdom of God. Truth, Zacchaeus. That you need to honor the Lord and people in your giving and in your wealth. Grace, come down from that tree because I'm going to your house today. The lame man who was laid at Jesus' feet, grace, your sins are forgiven. Truth, get up and walk. The prostitute, truth, you have many, many sins. Grace, they are forgiven. Go in peace. The adulterous woman, truth, you've been trying to find your sexuality or your identity in your sexuality. Grace, I will be your Messiah and your Savior. Peter, truth. I want you to get behind me when you act like Satan, but grace, I want you to follow me for all the days of your life. Truth, do you love me? Grace, do you love me? That he goes to the rich young ruler and he says, in grace, I love you. In truth, sell all that you have and give it to the poor. Do you see it? In every conversation, Jesus shared both truth and grace. And that's what we need to do so that the relationship can grow. That's how we have those kind of conversations. And we see that in Scripture. Ephesians chapter 4 says this, be angry and do not sin. Meaning, there's going to come times in your relationships that you're going to get angry with one another. If you're dating somebody, you're going to get angry. If you're friends, you're going to get angry. If you're family, you're going to get angry. And if you're married, you're going to get angry. But when you get angry, don't sin. Handle it properly. Well, how do you handle it properly? He tells us. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. All that means is handle conflict in a timely manner. Don't let it fester. When you let it fester, what you're doing is you're putting it down at the bottom and you're allowing all kinds of tension. Okay? But when you handle it in a timely manner, you're saying, hey, I want to talk about some truth for a second. That I got to make sure that I don't, when I'm at work and there's a fellow staff member, that I'm not letting it fester, but I'm handling it in a timely manner. That with my friend, I'm handling conflict in a timely manner. With a spouse, I'm handling it in a timely manner. Meaning, before you go to bed, deal with it. Let me say that again. Before you go to bed, deal with it. That doesn't mean it's going to be solved when you go to sleep. Let's admit it. Some things are going to take weeks or months to work through. But what it means is before you go to bed, you're looking each other eye to eye and you're saying, I love you and I'm committed to you and this is not going to interfere in our relationship because we're not going to let the devil have a foothold. We're not going to let the devil have an opportunity. We're not going to let the devil hold us down. We talked about that last week. We don't want the devil to get into our relationships. And when we don't deal with things, we allow the devil in. So if you're married, look each other in the eye and say, we're going to work through this because I am committed. And then one other way to handle communication, it says this. You better put your big boy pants on for a second, okay? Don't use foul or abusive language. Can I read that again? Some of you are like, no. Yeah, we all do. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. I want you to think about the last time you had an argument where you void of all those things. Or did you let them in? See, what Paul is saying is get rid of that stuff so that you don't sin in your anger. And then he continues on. He says, instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. What he's saying is handle it with truth and grace. And then we look at connection, we look at conversation, and we also look in one other way towards Christ. About what it means to stay committed. And the way that Christ was committed to us was the way he contributed. Like I want you to go back to Christ, and I want you to think about this inside of your relationships, family, friends, marriage, that you have to connect, especially when it's tough. Stay connected. When it's tough, when there's conflict, make sure that you're communicating. And then also make sure you're contributing. Because in our relationship with Christ, he came and he connected and he communicated, but then he contributed. He looked at us and said, you're not going to be able to restore this relationship without my help. So what Jesus did is he not only came to this earth, but he went to the cross and he died for each and every one of us. that he was 100% in the entire way. That Jesus didn't come 50% of the way and say, now come meet me. See, that's what we try to do in our relationships. I'll come 50%, you come 50%. Let me tell you right now, that is math that will lead to destruction. Jesus didn't come 70%. He didn't come 99% of the way. He came 100% of the way, all the way in, fully contributing by going to the cross and dying for our sins. He said, I'm doing everything that is needed so that you can be back into a right relationship with me. And we need to look at our relationships and do the same thing. We need to look at our friendships, our family, our marriages, and say, I'm fully invested. I'm fully in. In a marriage, that looks like submission. In all relationships, honestly, it's submission. Ephesians 5:21 says, submit to one another. Kids, submit to your parents. Employees, submit to your employer. Spouse, submit to one another. Verse 22 spells it out. It says, wives, submit to your husbands as an act of honor. The very next verse says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. And what did he do? He died. That he fully submitted and surrendered his life for us. And so that's what we need to be doing in our marriages, is submitting and surrendering to restore and to keep together and to remain together inside of that marriage. So that's the challenge today, is that we would look at our relationships with truth and grace. And that we would do everything we can to remain. And here's the beauty, is what I've tried to share with you, is what a relationship with Jesus looks like also. We're going to think about that and talk about that as we go into this time of response. And I want you to hear this, that everything I've been sharing will help you in your relationships with family members. It'll help you in your relationship with your spouse. It'll help you with your relationship with a friend. But most importantly, it's going to help you with your relationship with Jesus. Because Jesus says, I want to connect with you. Will you connect with me? Will you quit running? Will you quit hiding? And will you just connect with me? Jesus says, I want to communicate with you. I want to share some truth and grace. Will you communicate with him? That Jesus says, I've contributed everything for our relationship. Will you contribute everything back? Because see, again, Jesus doesn't ask for 1%. He asks for all of it. He says, be 100% in. Surrender your life. Pick up your cross and follow me. And the beautiful thing is, Jesus is committed. Do you realize his very last words on earth? Do you know what they were? He said, surely, I'm with you to the very end of the age. That Jesus was saying, I'm not leaving you. I'm not forsaking you. I'm not going anywhere. I'm not throwing you away. I'm not giving up on the relationship. I am 100% in until the end. And what would it look like if we entered that way into our relationship with Jesus? Because this is what I believe. If we were 100% into our relationship with Jesus, it would be a whole lot easier to be 100% in our relationship with our marriage. It would be a whole lot easier to be 100% in our relationship with our family. Because we'd start to understand, well, wow, the way Jesus loves me, I've got to love somebody else. So how about it? Will you commit today? Will you commit to a relationship with Jesus and then commit to the relationships that you are in your life? And I know it's hard, but you're not alone. See, God is working. We're going to sing a song right now. And in this song, we're going to sing about even when you don't see it, he's working. That he can do miracles in that relationship. He can do miracles in your life. He can make a way. We're going to follow that by singing a song about his faithfulness, that even in the midst of darkness, he is faithful, and he is faithful to bring gardens where we see graves. See, there's a lot of truth in his word, but there's also a lot of grace. So right now, I'm going to ask us to stand up. And I'm going to ask us to connect with Jesus and commit to him. Maybe you want to do that by taking communion up front on the stage as communion. And maybe you want to do it by spending some time in a prayer corner. Maybe what you need to do is, maybe you're at home watching, or maybe you're here and you just want to grab your spouse and say, let's just go and let's renew our commitment to the Lord. Maybe things are going great in your marriage, but you're just like, man, I just want to, before the Lord, just confess our commitment. Maybe things have been tough. Maybe right now is a good opportunity to say, we're going to connect more. We're going to communicate more. We're going to contribute more because we're committed to the Lord and to each other. Or maybe you're here and you've never surrendered to Jesus Christ before in your life. Man, now's the time. Now's the time to say, I'm ready to commit. I'm all in. You can come to the Connect Corner right there. There's going to be some of us there. We'd love to pray with you. Maybe you need to take a step of baptism. We'd love to give you that opportunity. Let's go before the Lord. Let's sing this song. And let's allow his grace and his truth to kind of wash over us. And let's make some commitments to him. Let's do that right now.
If you feel like all these miracles that you hear talk about God, you might be thinking, but that's not me. You don't know my problem. You don't know what I'm going through. He does. He knew the problem Moses went through and still parted his Red Sea. He is not any different today than he was then. What he did for Moses, what he did for Abraham, what he did for Elijah, he will do for you. He has not changed. His power is not different. He has not lost his ability to do the miracles that he did then. He can do them in your life too. He is a way maker. He is a miracle worker. He is a promise keeper. I want you to sing it, and I want you to declare it. I want you to sing it until you believe it.
That is who you are. the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn when you speak a word, it will come to pass. And yes, great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness. My hope and firm foundation.